Hi folks, welcome to Solara Technical. In today's video, I'm continuing my series on grounding. In my last video, I discussed how grounds are used to protect buildings from lightning strikes. The link's at the end of this video. Today, I'll discuss substation grounding. IEEE Standard 80 is the guide for safety in AC substation grounding. Guess what? This spec is all about building a low impedance ground system below soil level and making sure all the conductors can handle whatever fault current might develop and bonding the heck out of any metal above ground. Does this sound anything like my lightning protection video? It should. There's a sister standard, number 81, for testing substation grounds. Safety is all about limiting the current that's possible to flow through the human, whether that be hand-to-hand, hand-to-foot, foot-to-foot, or even our rear end to foot or hand. Does this sound like my ground fault circuit interrupter video? It should. We need to limit the current the human can see under any condition and stop it as quickly as possible, whether that be in small AC receptacles or in large substation circuits. In a substation, we need to keep the maximum voltage gradient below a safe level during a ground fault event. How do we achieve this? By providing a low impedance ground path for said fault current and open or clear the fault quickly. Just like in our lightning protection, having as close to a perfect ground is required. In particular, how is this done for substations? We've already learned soil is a poor conductor of electricity, and, as you can imagine, it's highly variable in its properties. Add to this the effects of water, whether rain or snow, and we get even more variability. Since natural soil is so variable, even after measuring it to see if it's acceptable as is, it's usually excavated and backfilled with known material, most often consisting of two layers, a larger and deeper layer of select fill, which really means wood consistent characteristics, and an upper, smaller layer of common fill, since it doesn't matter so much. Almost without exception, crushed rock is the final top layer. This gravel layer is an important design consideration for step potentials, as it acts somewhat like an insulator, so long as fines are not used and the size of the rock is consistent. In fact, some utilities will not energize a substation until the rock is in place. Something called remote earths are built in an attempt to produce perfect grounds throughout the substation. Mathematically, they're considered to be at zero potential ground. But their 100-foot long ground rods are about 18 milliohms at 60 hertz. Not a big deal, you say? Hit one with 7,000 amps of fault current and we'll see 125 volts across it from end to end. The resistance of that same rod is only a milliohm or two, so the inductive impedance dominates by 10x. Low inductance is more important than low resistance, just like in our lightning mitigation design. How do we guarantee low inductance? It's hard to measure, so we measure the resistance of a predefined mesh and pier network that, together, achieves this low inductance. It has lots of parallel paths, both horizontal and vertical, and, as you know, inductors in parallel lower the overall inductance. Grids of 2-aught copper are buried 1/2 meter in depth, with 7 1/2 meter long ground rods, or 25 feet. Before this is all buried, it's connected with either exothermic welding or now an approved swage connection. Swage is a generic term used for a cold forging process using compression to make the connection. We need to be aware of the buried items belonging to others as we make sure our fault currents stay within our ground field and don't jump over to some other path we aren't counting on. The last thing we want is to endanger someone through a sneak path. As always, If you'd like help with anything related to power, please give us a call. We're here to help. Thanks for watching.